Hello, I'm Dr. Ron England, and this is the final video of the game programming series. I may at some point do a demonstration of some other game tactics, but techniques, but and this is the last one of the game programming series. And first thing I'll do is I'll actually show you the game that we're working with here. So I'm going to hit this button that says begin here, and there's my game. And notice I got pink balls and green, or pink rectangles and green rectangles going across the screen. Let me describe how this game works, and then I'll explain to you how I make it work. I've got these two rectangles, both pink and yellow, that are going across the screen. And if they make it to the other side, this red bar right here, they're going to increment their score by one. Well, that'd be great, except that you actually have to have some level of interactivity. So what I can do here to show the interactivity of this is if I click on something, okay, it'll change direction. So if I have the yellow, I say, click the yellow, got to hit it. Terrible. There it goes. If I click the yellow, it changes direction. But that green's going to hit it. But I can change its direction too, and I can change it again and give the yellow a nice clear pathway back to the wall. And then I can click on the, if I can hit the pink one, I can send it back even before it bounces all the way to the back wall. You're going ahead and moving that score up. And if I go down here, so the pink is now 4 and the yellow is 3. When one of these yellow or pink ones, my scoring rectangles, touch a green rectangle, the green rectangle will change direction. And if I click on a green rectangle, it'll change direction. So the game actually dynamically changes all the time based on the position of the different rectangles and what has touched what. So, a simplistic game, has some level of playability, kind of a lot of fun, but it's really fun in a demonstration of some of the things that you can do very easily, and then you can apply your imagination to really make it a playable game. So I'm going to do something here. I'm actually going to pause it. I have set it so that it will pause, and I'll show you how I did that. So let's scroll this guy over here, and let's start looking at the code. Well, the first thing is that you just saw that pause. Let's look at that. I declare a variable called timer that I set to equal to -1, and I have a begin button. And if the timer is -1, it sets the interval, which calls the animation function, which you should know if you've been looking at the other videos, actually causes the animation to go. And if the timer is not equal to -1, meaning that the timer is actually clicking through time, it's going to clear the interval and then set the timer back to -1. So that you can actually, which is kind of nice because I can actually bring the game back over here if I want to, and I can hit begin, and the game will just start off where it left off. So I can pause it once again. So that's how I did that. And it's really straightforward programming. You're basically keeping track of the state of the game there. I'm not going to go through how we build the animations on top of an animation frame. That's all pretty straightforward. I have some variables for the scores, which are all pretty straightforward. But let's get down here and actually look at something that is really important to understand if you're going to build a game. I have three defined rectangles here, yellow, green, and pink. Okay. This is a very important concept of objects. The rectangles, I've set up an array of rectangles. In this case, there are 6 rectangles, 0 through 5. And if I were to set rectangle 2 to the green rectangle, rectangle 3 to the green rectangle, rectangle 4 to the green rectangle, they would all be the same rectangle. So anytime I set the property of any of those rectangles, because they're the same, the properties of all the rectangles in that series will also change. So what you have to do if you want to use the base properties of that rectangle but make it a new object, okay, make it a new object, you have to clone it. Some people say deep copy, some people say clone. jQuery has a nice, easy function called extend, which will allow you to extend the properties of the green rectangle to a new object, which is also a rectangle, has all the same properties, but it's a copy of that. And so I was able to, when I created these green rectangles, all I did was take the green rectangle, which had defined properties, and I reset the x in each case to different values so that the rectangle started at a different point. Okay, that is really crucially important because if you're doing a game, it's very likely that you're going to have multiple objects that you want to just make a copy of another object and change the properties of that object. Now, a lot of times in game programming, you'll do something like called a rectangle generator, where it simply can generate a new rectangle all the time, and that would be a function. Okay, so as you can see, that's one of the things that you can do in JavaScript, and built into jQuery is this extend. Other than that, there's just simply applying the rules of the game. Now, if you looked at what we did with the code in the previous lectures, there's nothing here that's uniquely new of the other code. I did do some changes, like I defined the location of the right wall and the left wall, and when I'm animating the individual rectangles, I check, you know, whether it's hit the wall and then change the direction. I did change the way that I did my collision detection, because now I'm no longer interested if the yellow rectangle collides with the pink rectangle. I'm really only concerned when either of the rectangles collides with one of the green rectangles. And I just defined that the yellow rectangle is rectangle 0, okay, the pink rectangle is rectangle 1, and then 2, 3, 4, and 5 are green rectangles, so that when I'm checking the collision situations, all I got to do is look at those rectangles, the green, the pink, or the yellow colliding with the green. And in the cases there, I just simply do things like change the direction. Changing the direction of the rectangle is simply changing the Y step or the X step, which will change the Y direction and the X direction to be the opposite of what they are, which is simply multiplying it times its current value by negative 1. So I did change a little bit also. I've made it so that each rectangle has its fill color, and it can change color, okay, which would be its current color. Okay, and I'm gonna find that. And but then it can always change back to its fill color, which is its default color, which I don't change. All the other aspects of this have been described very well in the previous lectures. So what I've added to this that's new is the begin button, which causes it to begin and end so that it goes on. The ability to score, so that when some specific event occurs, like the rectangle's hitting the right wall, okay, it actually increments a score. And the fact that I now have got this ability to make multiple rectangles in the array by making clones of an existing object, which in this case is the green rectangle. So as I go back to my game here, I'm going to scroll it up a little bit so you can see it in action. Click the begin button, and away it goes. And see as I can see them hitting the walls, and I'm going to hit pink back, go back, pink, and they're really hard to click sometimes. Okay. Uh-oh, and the yellow's going to hit, and this green is in the way. Okay. Now, if you can take what I've done here and let your imagination go with this, what kind of things, by the way, just a quick thing, what kind of things could you do with this? Well, in this case, I've had the green rectangles all going up and down. I could have them going left and right. Or I can make a game where rectangles of a same color, if they collide, something occurs. Or maybe you've got to get rectangles to line up with each other and touch each other. I've seen games like that. And if you do that, you can score. And let's say the rectangles will disappear if you do that. But now you can see that even some of the complex games, other than the fact that they have really pretty graphics, because all I did in this case was draw rectangles, but I could use any image now. Okay, I'm just making it nice and simple with these rectangles. And I just simply define the rules of the game. And I've actually got written down all sorts of fun games and programmed lots of fun games that are really playable. But this is a really good example of creating a game. Thank you very much, and good programming. And I hope this lets you generate all sorts of really cool and interesting games that people can play. Thanks very much.